know, but I don't think Miles really, you know, first knew what to do with a woman except drag her into his lair.
By the time we got to Woodstock,
folk music and jazz occupied the same room at different times, and there was an overlap sometimes. The point we differed on was electronic music. And I thought, I already went through this in the folk circles, you know, like Pete Seeger crying when Bob plugged in. You know, people are afraid that they can't make that change. Not everybody is fluid and changeable. I am, Miles is. Some people thrive on change. But every time you change, you have to be ready to experience massive rejection.
Listen a minute, will you? Listen a minute. Now listen, a lot of people who get up here and sing, I know it's fun, you know, it's a lot of fun. It's fun for me. I get my feelings off through my music. But listen, you got your life wrapped up in it. Give us some respect.
Most of music, pop music, it's like they get these formula chords. Well, the people like these chords, and so they play them ad nauseum. You know, so I think that's ick. Music is when you pull the chords from your inner core, whether they sound weird to people or not. And so, and anyone adventuresome is doing that. And Miles certainly was adventuresome. The beast had changed its mind that we were human, and they let everybody after that do their thing.
Everybody was interested in playing with Miles because he was the number one band. The Isle of Wight, like I said, that was about my third concert with the band. That music was a transitional music. That was the music he had been playing in the band before. Now, once I joined the band, we were on our way to play different music. I was coming from a totally acoustic, you know, I hadn't dealt with electricity. Initially, electricity, well, that's something, you know, you get from Con Ed, you know. But in reality, electricity is life itself. So how can I say I don't, you know, I'm not into electricity when I'm electric? We all are electric. Miles didn't change through the years. He got better, I think. But as far as musically, he didn't change. Things around him changed. The world changed, okay? So what are you going to do? The world changes. You're going to stay in those old trappings. You're still going to wear the clothes that you wore back in the 40s. You know, you keep up. So he just kept up. That's all.
Most of what we did was an improvisation. It was a jam. Miles had certain themes that he would bring in that would establish a tempo and a groove. And then he may have some melodic themes on the top, and then he would just set a mood.
I think there's a certain point where you have so many people out there that it no longer means anything in a way. I don't know. We got on stage and we started playing, and you know, you're this very small event that's in this huge space of things that are going on, and you know, the sound is coming from all over the place and like that. So there's a sort of detachment that happens sometimes in those large concerts that's different from the more intimate venues. But it was a stunning sight to see that. For a as I was concerned. You know, every time Miles put the horn to his lips, it was a great event. The bass player has a tremendous responsibility, I think, in the music to create a center, to create a focus within the music that Miles is creating. But how you do that can change tremendously from one musical situation to another. What I did with Miles was influenced by the things that I heard around me at those times. You know, what Jack Bruce was doing with the Cream, what Jimmy was doing with his band, you know, and of course there was also the influences of James Brown's music and a lot of the other things that were going on at that time.
Miles' music was crossing over then at that point. And so he was reaching a larger audience. And a lot of the rock musicians were really also getting turned on to Miles, and really, it was a great meeting of the musical cultures. The drummer was the anchor. It was the function of laying down the groove, especially in that electric period. Laying down the groove and also embellishing the groove, you know, keeping a steady pulse but changing it, shifting it, you know, making subtle changes in it, and providing the fire, stoking the fire, you know, putting the heat on it with our ear, and putting the colors on top of what I was doing.
The first thing that I played at the Isle of Wight was cuíca. It's called cuíca. And actually, Miles used to love this sound. We used to play, you know, off each other. When he went, you know, I went, you know, that thing. And I know he liked it, even though he never told me, but I know he liked it. We flew to the site, and it was very incredible to look to see all the people, you know, on the roads and everything, and out, you know, off the roads, like they were like ants, you know. It was incredible. And we were right there, in the middle of everything. Before us, I think, was the Tiny Tim. And then they announced Miles Davis and band, blah, blah. And then I just, you know, I walked in on stage, and that was it. And then we played that beautiful concert. That was incredible. And it's incredible that I can remember that, because I was pretty out that time.
Are you in a trance? That's a good question. This is the limit of what two hands can do on the piano, and I go into this other place, which you might term a trance. You can actually do things you hear that are so unrelated to your instrument that they are frightening to even yourself. Probably knew that I didn't want to even get near an electric piano, but he might have figured that if